Chair calls the May 1st Stanley County Board of Education meeting to order. I'd like to welcome all of you here tonight. We have some special things to go on tonight, and we're glad for you to share in the process. Without further ado, we'll call on Mr. Ryan McIntyre to do our invocation.
You'll please bow. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, and we thank you so much for all that you do for us. We thank you for the wonderful weather and for bringing us all here tonight safely. And we ask for your wisdom and guidance as we make decisions for Stanley County Schools. In your holy name, amen. Amen. If you'll please stand for the pledge.
We have a special event at this time that will remind some of us how old we are. Mr. Jonathan Brooks from East Albemarle, we'll let you take it away. Got the East Albemarle jump rope team. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
You all in for a special treat tonight. We have our fifth grade jump rope team, the Bullpup Pounders. Most of these students have been jumping for 2 to 3 years. Like Mr. Poole said, they are gonna remind us just how old we are. They're gonna do some amazing things. They love the applause. So cheer them on, root for them, and I hope you enjoy. We're gonna have Amari Baldwin. We're gonna have Allison Croft. We have Nevaeh. We have Gavin Colson and Jeremiah. They're going to be our fifth grade Bullpup Pounders, so make some noise for them and cheer them on. Thank you.
Come from where did you go? Where did you come from? Cotton I do. Get out and into Cotton I do. I've been married long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Cotton I do.
Everybody, I'm from the night.
therapy.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks, and the jump ropers. A little bit creative, I say. We have several recognitions tonight, and I think sometimes public education gets hammered a little bit, but I think we have some presentations that will let you know that public education is still doing its job. Dr. James.
I'll ask Danny Poplin, if he would, and if he would join me up front, and we'll consider these recognitions tonight. We do appreciate the kids for all their hard work. I did get to go down to Skills USA, and Georgia Harvey, if you would step up, she's a big part of this. Was fortunate enough to get to run down to Skills USA and see quite a few of our students get accolades at that event. So I do appreciate their hard work and all the kids that are on the agenda tonight, the great work you're doing in our county. It celebrates what great things are going on in our public schools. Sometimes we get drugged down into what's not working, but there's a lot of great things that are working in our schools. So join me up front if you would, and we'll recognize these students.
Well, good evening. I'm honored this evening to be able to present to you the Kids Speak Out Competition winners. Stanley County Schools 4th and 5th grade students participated for the first time in the Optimist Club's Kids Speak Out Oratorical Contest on March 16th. The candidates were challenged to speak for 2 minutes using the prompt, "Can Society Exist Without Respect?" Each child was judged with a rubric, and first, second, and third place winners were chosen and honored with gold, silver, and bronze medals. All children that participated in the district contest did an outstanding job, and there were winners that came from each of the school levels. They gained valuable insights into public speaking through this experience. We hope to make this an annual event for the district. And Ms. Gibson was one of our judges, so she can attest to how difficult it was to pick the winners. And so tonight we'd like to recognize our first, second, and third place winners. First of all, the third place was Jalen Pig from Central Elementary. Is Jalen here? Second Second place was Logan Diss from Stanfield. And our first place winner was Vincent Gregory from East Albemarle.
Career and technical education programs in our schools strive to prepare our students for success in post-secondary education, careers, and as leaders. We recognize tonight outstanding student achievement in these organizations at the state level. There'll be FBLA, FFA, and Skills USA. I'd like to first ask John Thompson from West Stanley High School FBLA to step forward to the mic, please.
My name is John Thompson. I'm an advisor for West Stanley High School Future Business Leaders of America. This is Bailey Queen. He's our local chapter president. Last month, over 2,200 students attended the State Leadership Conference in Greensboro, North Carolina. West Stanley was in attendance. At this conference, our students attend business and leadership seminars and participate in competitive events. This year, 13 out of our 18 students were recognized on stage as top five. We had several top second place and third place winners. And with these competitions, we're competing against schools that are much larger, with much larger memberships, in some cases over 200 members. Also each year, our officers submit a business report that details all of our chapter activities throughout the year, things such as business partnerships, community service, results of competitions, and other leadership development activities. Based on these submissions, a small percentage received the prestigious Gold Seal Chapter Award. This year, West Stanley, under the leadership of Bailey Queen, was one of only five chapters in North Carolina out of over 200 chapters to receive this award. And I will say just a shout out to our alumni. This is 15 out of the last 20 years that we've received this award. I would like to next call FFA North Stanley High School, Mr. Danny Blake.
I am Danny Blake, and I have with me my teaching partner, Danielle Rushing. And first of all, we participated on March 29th in the state poultry contest. It was held in Raleigh. There were 85 schools from across the state there and over 320 students, and we were first. And if those students would come up here, please, to get recognized tonight. First of all, fifth in the contest, now 320 students with Mara Jacobs. Seventh in the contest was Amber Robertelli. And also our other two members, Meredith Simpson and Hope Dobie, were also in the top 20% of the students there, and they will get to go to Indianapolis, Indiana to participate in the national contest in October. And also, we'd like to just take 1 minute while they're getting a picture. We also had our big regional rally last Friday, and Mr. Rushing is going to tell you how we did in that.
Last Friday, we took 23 of our members to our regional rally. It was at Rowan Cabarrus Community College. Our students did very well. They placed fourth for our tool judging team. Our ag mechanics team was second. Our forestry team was third. We had a Creed speaker who was second place. Job interview was seventh place. We had a floriculture team that was first, and an introduction to horticulture team that was also first. And all of our teams that were in the top three, they get to go to state competition, which is in Raleigh, June 19th through the 21st.
I would like to call next Skills USA. The high school advisor will present in this order. We'll ask Mr. Sorensen if he would come first, please.
Good evening. We're here to recognize some of the South Stanley Skills USA members for awards that they received at the recent convention in Greensboro. The first one we'll talk about is the Outstanding Members Award. The Outstanding Member Award is a state-level recognition of Skills USA members that embody the motto of the organization, preparing for leadership in the world of work. The South Stanley criteria include 2 years of active membership, holding a chapter office, earning a medal at a skills event regional or above, maintaining exceptional academic and attendance in all classes. And this year's South Stanley High School Outstanding Members are Douglas Poplin, couldn't be here tonight, he's at work. Derek Olson, you guys can come on up. James Harris. Levi Coley. Levi Carpenter, he's not here tonight either. Madison Wood. And Devin Banks. Now we also have two very special recognitions. You guys can stay up here. From the South delegation tonight, the first goes to a young man that has won the Action Skills Demonstration Contest for 3 straight years in a row. He is the first skills member in the South Stanley history to represent the state of North Carolina at the national 3 times consecutively. He has finished last year of 11th in the nation. Certainly bodes well for him, for his chances in Louisville. Mr. Derek Olson is a 3-time state champion in action sports. And anybody that knows about electronics knows he likes to play with Tesla coils, which scares me to death. Moving right along. Another first for South Stanley squad this year was the awarding of the Willis M. Parker Leadership Award. This award is given to a student who has shown outstanding dedication to their chapter and its members and have expressed a sincere dedication to the organization and its members. Dr. Willis M. Parker was the founding father of North Carolina State University, VICA, which is the founder of Skills USA. This VICA chapter was the first collegiate chapter to be chartered in the nation in 1968. And Mr. Levi Carpenter is South Stanley's first ever recipient of this prestigious award. Well, Levi couldn't be here. I tried to, but I couldn't get him to reschedule his birthday for a board meeting. So. Last thing I'd like to point out is South Stanley is one of only 2 traditional high schools in the state to receive the Bronze Chapter of Distinction. There's 4 schools in the state that got it. 2 of them are charters, charter stems, and South Stanley in one of their schools. So congratulations to these guys. Right here.
This time I would like to ask Ms. Vivian Barnett to come, and she is representing North Stanley High School.
Good evening. I'm Vivian Barnett, and I have my co-advisor, Kathy Johnson. We're representing North Carolina, North Stanley. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about what our students have been doing this year. The Skills USA motto, preparing for leadership in the world of work. This outstanding member award is a state-level recognition for the SkillsUSA members, and we have embraced that at North Stanley High School. North Stanley's outstanding members have met several criteria that they have to meet to become outstanding members. In order to be an outstanding member, each member must have been nominated by their advisor. The process includes an application identifying their qualifications and SkillsUSA activities. Along with this statement from their advisor on their behalf, they have to have met several regional and state competitions. They have to have medaled in a competition. Along with medaling in a competition, their GPA must have been met at the highest level. Above maintaining their GPA, most of these members have been chapter officers, regional officers. Some have pursued as well a state officer dream. Some of these members have went to Camp Dixie more than once. Camp Dixie is the only place that you can obtain a state leadership award. All have proven that they are SkillsUSA champions and that they are job ready from day one. For the first time in the history of North Stanley High School, they all have participated in the Chapter of Excellence program, and they have earned the quality chapter level. At the opening ceremonies, they were recognized on the stage for this honor. At this time, I'm not sure where my students are. They are scattered, but I would like for them to come up. I would like to introduce to you Anna Ward, Peter Beltnick, Mara Jacobs, Kong Mwa, and Cole Harbison, who are all outstanding members for North Stanley High School SkillsUSA. And we have one more honor. We had a first-time winner this year, Peter Beltnick, the young gentleman right there. Peter Beltnick placed first in a new category this year. It was for Adobe Digital Design. He placed first in the state. However, it was not a national contest because it is brand new. However, that does not lessen the fact that he is a state winner, and we are very proud of Peter. So, North Stanley SkillsUSA.
At this time for West Stanley, we'd like to ask Stephen Honeycutt and Mr. Adam Storms to come to the mic, please.
Members of the board, distinguished guests, my name is Adam Storms. I teach electronics at West Stanley High School, and my co-advisor, Stephen Honeycutt, is not able to make it today, so I will be doing double duty. In construction tool ID, a state contest for SkillsUSA, we had a state winner by the name of Hunter Morton, and unfortunately he's working tonight, so I couldn't pull him away from his job. That is usually a very well-attended contest. It's only a state contest, it's not a national contest, but he went against quite a few other competitors and ended up top in the state, so congratulations to Hunter. For electronics, the top in the state, which is a national contest, goes to our very own Jacob Berlinski. As a 10th grader, I see a lot of promise in this young man, so I look forward to him competing from here on and winning this contest over and over again, right? As an aside, although it's not a SkillsUSA thing, I would like to mention that during the electronics blast hosted by Stanley Community College, Wes Stanley did win the Top Gun Award, and much of it was on the shoulders of this young man.
This time I would like to ask Ms. Mandy Melton if she would come forward, please, and she's going to go over the Career Readiness Work Keys recipients for the county.
Good evening. As part of the North Carolina Department of Instruction's goal to provide a comprehensive approach to college and career readiness, the Work Keys assessment helps to prepare students with essential workplace skills. Senior students qualify to take the Work Keys examination by taking 4 career and technical education courses within a career pathway. The Work Keys system measures soft skills, specifically applied math, graphic literacy, and workplace documents. These are skills that employers feel are critical to job success. The Work Keys test results will help students understand their strengths and their weaknesses and how they can improve their skills in order for better paying jobs. Students who take the Work Keys test receive a credential that enables them to document their abilities to future employers. This credential is known as the National Career Readiness Certificate. This certificate provides evidence that the individual has the skills needed in the workplace. The certificate is awarded at 1 of 4 levels: bronze, silver, gold, and platinum. The following students scored at the platinum level. A platinum score indicates that the students are prepared for 99% of the jobs in the ACT Job Pro database. In the 2017-2018 school year, only 4,500 students statewide received this high achievement. And if you guys will come forward as I call your name. From Albemarle High School, Logan McDonald. From North Stanley High School, Peter Beltnick. Grace Benfield. Tanner Carrick. Kaylin Cottle. Ayanna Morrison. Shane Pappin. Maggie Smith. Sherwin Wang. From the Stanley Early College, Miles Shin. Christopher Bearden. And Robert Bisbee. From South Stanley High School, Levi Carpenter. Samuel Coley, Jake Dennis, Nathaniel Lambert, Kimball Midget, Caitlin Purdy, Blythe Ross. From West Stanley High School, Elena Houck. Bailey Honeycutt. Trinity McClellan. Addison Rolls. William Starnes. Trent Stegall. And Mazden Thomas. Congratulations again to these students.
Tall guys on the back, not so tall on the front.
And I'd like to apologize. Apparently we missed one. That's my fault. From North Stanley. She's got to help me with the name. Exidu Zhang.
The University of North Carolina's Go Global North Carolina is sponsoring a China 2018 professional development program that is designed to allow North Carolina participants the opportunity to learn about the unique challenges facing China as they strive to educate a country of 1.4 billion people and what lessons we can take away for our own schools. The program is available for North Carolina teachers from all grade levels and subject areas. Stanley County is fortunate to be the recipient of the Hayes Charitable Trust Award, which funds the participation of Stanley County Schools Teacher of the Year. The Hayes Charitable Trust Teacher Award will cover the full cost of the program of approximately $6,500. At this time, it is my pleasure to award Christy Edwards, a math teacher at West Stanley High School, with the Hayes Charitable Trust Award.
Chair would like to recognize Dr. Kevin Adams, or Mr. Kevin Adams, from the Early College.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having us. We're here before you today to talk about some of the great things going on at Stanley Early College. And as you've already seen, there's a lot of great things going on in Stanley County Schools. And we are glad to be a part of that and part of what's going on in our public schools. I almost thought about bringing my jump rope for the presentation, and now I'm glad I decided not to. So I just decided that would be best to leave that at home. I'm here with Miles Shen, and Miles will be talking to you in just a minute about his experiences at early college. I just wanted to share some of the information as to what's going on in our schools. And on the PowerPoint in front of you, that is our student body this year. We have approximately 200 students. And if a picture's worth 1,000 words, that picture represents 50,000 hours of community service. Approximately 190, if history's any judge, 190 of those students will earn their associate's degree. And 80% of them come from households that parents do not have a four-year degree. And so if a picture's worth 1,000 words, that says a lot about the legacy of what's gone on at Stanley Early College so far. And so we are very proud of what our students do. Academically, in Stanley County, public schools are the highest performing schools in Stanley County. Stanley Early College is the only A school in Stanley County. That includes charter schools. Our students are growing as well. In the three core areas, we meet academic growth. And as a school, in all of our subjects, including our common final exams, Stanley Early College teachers exceed and students exceed growth with a score of 4.93. So public schools are doing it in Stanley County, not just what you see with CTE, but the academic capability of our students as reflected in the data that I have before you tonight. The other thing about our students at Early College, our middle schools are sending us students who are academically prepared to do our program. The next slide that I have there, 71.4% of our incoming eighth graders at Stanley Early College come grade level ready to us. The other ones that may be not at grade level proficiency, we're gonna get them there. Because right now, this year and this academic year, our data's looking like in math one, we're going to be at 88% proficiency, first semester 86% proficiency in biology, and we do English two, second semester we're gonna do 90. And that is our goal as a school, is that 90% of our students will be proficient in those three core areas. So not only am I hoping that we'll have an A next year, we're going back to the 90s. So the other thing I wanted to bring up about our students at Early College, that percentage of economically disadvantaged students. Greystone has about 11% of their students that are economically disadvantaged. We are 43.8% at Stanley Early College. We're also 42% of our students are minority students as well. So we supersede the county average, and it says a lot about the students and teachers and what happens in Stanley County. How do we do this? One of the things that we do is how we approach our kids. We grow our students by doing these five things in our classrooms. Every classroom you come in, every single day at Stanley Early College, these things are going on. Every day, every student, reading, writing, thinking, and speaking. And our collaborative group work, classroom talk, scaffolding, writing to learn, and questioning, those key strategies right there are the best research-based strategies that you can get. And it doesn't matter if you, whatever research you read, they'll come back to those strategies. And so they grow kids of all ability levels. And that's kind of where those numbers come from. And I don't think we can go without talking about our numbers without talking about how our teachers do that and sharing collaborative ideas with what we do in our schools. All right. Another part of early college, and my staff bet me I could not do this in 5 minutes. So if I do it in 5 minutes, I have won a bet today. We have a very collaborative relationship with Stanley Community College as well. Students that come to early college, we do not use a lottery. Our students earn their way in. They get interviewed. They have, you can ask the middle school principals and guidance counselors. They get recommendations. We use a rubric system that they earn their way into our school. I mentioned already, 80% of our students are first generation. Our students come and they complete. Currently, we are at 40 out of 46 students that are going to graduate in 2018 will earn their full associate's degree, or they will earn a certification in one of the key areas at Stanley Community College. Last year, that number was 39 out of 42. And every one of those kids that are graduating, all of them are going to go to college with transferable credits. And so we are meeting the goal of what early colleges were set up to do when they were established back in 2005, 2006. This semester, there's approximately 80 different college classes that Stanley Early College students are in. As a county, 300 Stanley County schools, high school students, are taking Career College Promise courses on the campuses at Stanley Community College. So this is not just an early college thing. This is happening across the board for all our students earning those degrees and earning those numbers. I mentioned about community service. This year alone, we've accumulated over 5,000 hours of volunteer community service hours. Our 10th grade students just completed their capstone projects for English 4, and they raised, just those students alone, raised over $5,000 to donate to community charities and community service. Most of that they had to do on their own. And of course, all of this is paid through the state of North Carolina, through the taxpayers. The average tuition at Stanley Community College right now is $12,000 per semester for tuition and fees. If you would do the same transferable credits at UNC Charlotte, the full-time student tuition is $3,486.50. So we're saving parents at Stanley in Stanley County, we're saving them approximately $22,000 by sending their students to four-year schools with that transferable credit. And I just think it's just fantastic what is happening in terms of Stanley Early College. The next slide is our degree programs. And the great thing about Stanley Early College is our students can generally take any of the associate's degree pathways that are offered at Stanley Community College, which is great for the college to allow our students to do that, because some early colleges you can only get the general transfer. Our students can also do things like refrigeration and welding and so on and so forth. And when we take our students to visit these programs, many of these have job placement parts with them as well, that employers in the county and outside the county are looking for our employees. Some of these jobs have starting pays that are very competitive in terms of what you would get with a four-year degree. And we have students taking associate's degrees in all of these programs. We're also very active within the Stanley Community College community. Our students participate in just about anything that they do on the college side. These three students, the student in the Adidas shirt, Jalea, she is 10th grade. She took first place in the Stanley Community College Shark Tank business proposal. The other two students, Katie and Alasia, are 9th grade students. And they finished second, and they were able to earn some scholarship money from the college. Our students also partake in the Skills USA competition on the community college side. And our students placed first and fourth place in that competition as well. And so our students are getting a well-rounded representation. These are our three platinum winning students. They did not want me to take their picture. So I think that shows through in there. Miles, you're the only one smiling, sir. All right. College visits, career going, college culture is part of that. From 9th grade on, our students visit schools. And we get them to get a taste of all different kinds of schools. I believe this one is our current freshman class at Catawba College there. Our students are also college ready when they leave. They are competing against older students in many of these things and getting their works published. This is the list of students just in the Stanley Community College. These are all early college students who have their literary works published in the Muse Literary Magazine through Stanley Community College. And so our kids are getting such access to so many of these programs. These are some of our students at Crutchfield, our National Honor Society, induction. And that is, of course, our students at UNCG. And so we are serious about what we do with our students. This young man and his dog, he's with me. He's going to talk for just a minute. I took 5 minutes, right? Miles was just awarded. He's going to be graduating from Stanley Early College. He is going to be graduating, and he has earned the Levine Scholarship, which pays for all of his bachelor's degree. And then he also went ahead and earned the Belk degree, and that's going to pay for his master's degree. And so he's... I also have teenage daughters, and you can marry one of them if you'd like. All right, just saying, a couple years down the road, but keep that in mind, all right? And that is his dog, Claudia. Claudia, he trained her to be a service dog. That was his capstone project in 10th grade. And so he goes to local elementary schools, and she's trained to read. Not read, she's trained to be a therapeutic reading dog. And so if you could train her to read, that'd really be awesome. But she's trained so students can read to her, and that's part of what he does with his volunteer hour. This is Kayla Cole. Kayla, I got permission for Kayla's picture. Kayla has been blind since birth, and she is going to graduate this year from Stanley Early College with her associate's degree. and she has earned that in her own right. I asked her if I could take her picture, and Maple, which is her guide dog, immediately sat down and posed when I took a picture. It was very interesting. Kayla's going to be, there's going to be an article on her in the Snap about her accomplishments, and she'll be going to Liberty, I believe, on a scholarship to pursue music. She plays and sings beautifully enough to actually go to Liberty for that. These are our kids. Not only are our kids competing on the early college level and the community college level, this is kind of their graduation ads. We have a bulletin board. We got students on this board going to UNC Chapel Hill, UNC Charlotte, Pfeiffer, A&T, App State, all those schools. So we are going to be well represented next year around the schools in North Carolina. And as a community, the students that come to Stanley Early College, we should be very proud of their accomplishments. And I'm going to, at this point, be quiet and turn it over to Miles, and he's going to speak briefly about his experiences at Early College. Thank you for your time.
Good evening. My name is Miles Shen, and this is my final year at Stanley Early College High School. So I want to start by saying a big thank you to Stanley County Schools and Stanley Early College for getting me this far. I honestly couldn't have done it without them. So there's so many great things that I could say about Stanley Early College, but I'm going to keep it short and simple and touch on how caring the staff and faculty and teachers are for their students. I mean, my freshman and sophomore year, they really push you, they excel, they push you to excel. They expect academic prowess out of you. They really want you to learn, and they know everybody by name. I know Mr. Adams knows every single student at Stanley Early College by name, and that's something that really resonates within me as a student. I know it really touches the other students at Stanley Early College, just how much the faculty cares about us and wants us to succeed. So that's pretty much it, just how much Stanley Early College cares about its students. Thank you.
Mr. Adams, I think you could have talked all night. I don't blame you for being proud, and congratulations are definitely in order. Next, we have a presentation to the board by Mr. Anthony Grays and Mr. John Edwards.
Okay, before we get started, that was impressive.
It was.
That was awesome. Even though we didn't teach a dog how to read, that was still super impressive. I'm like, oh my God. No wonder you won those awards. That was great. Actually, all those students, and it's amazing. Stanley County Schools produces outstanding students every year, and it's exciting to come to the school board meetings, because outside of the school board meetings, you often don't hear about a lot of those things. So thank you. Chairman Poole and members of the school board, we appreciate you having us here tonight to talk about a topic that has probably been one of, if not the most controversial, discussed in the last 5 or 6 years here in the community, and that is the issue of school capacity. School capacity has been at the heart of the discussions around school closures and consolidations, and John and I, as well as everyone up there, and many people in the audience have been paying close attention to that matter over the previous years. So what we wanted to do tonight with our presentation was we wanted to talk about capacity and also provide a little bit of context to the numbers, because over the years, we and you have seen different numbers for capacities, not just different enrollment numbers, but different numbers. And any business person will tell you that you cannot make an informed decision if you don't have confidence in the data that you're working with. So the first thing that John and I wanted to do, because this matter was brought up in the public recently, again, was we wanted to find out, are the capacity numbers that we've all been working from, are they good numbers for us to have a discussion around? So What we did was, his son Tripp is here, John's son, and his daughter Lillian both attend Oakboro Choice STEM School. So we went to the school, and we were just going to do a quick little project. We were going to get a floor plan. We were going to take the number of classes, multiply them by 18, 19, 20, 24, 25. What we were going to try to do is we were going to try to arrive at the number on the top right-hand corner of the screen. If you can't read it, it says 412. And that is what the maximum capacity is supposed to be for Oakboro Choice STEM School. They have an enrollment of 299 students, and they have a reported capacity of 73%. So when we went there, first we had to determine how many classrooms do they have. And so the secretary at the school, she pulled out a handwritten floor plan, and she started writing out what classes were in which rooms. And as John and I watched her do this, something became very obvious to us. We had not talked about numbers with her, but she was filling in, and by the time she got done with the floor plan, 21 of the 22 classrooms at the school were being used. And so, to give you an idea what that looks like here, is that we're filling in right now, this is 73% of the available 22 classrooms, or 17 classrooms at Oakboro Choice STEM School. Now, it looks like there are 5 empty classrooms. However, if we take a look at the usage, we see kindergarten, first grade, second grade, all filling in. We have AIG, EC. We have only one available classroom, and that is being used for guidance, for testing, and also for storage by PTU. So technically, even though the reported capacity is 73%, the actual utilization, if we don't count the fact that they're using that one classroom as a multi-purpose room, it's at 95%. And so John and I wanted to see if that was going to be the same at the other schools. And so the second school that we went to was Aquadale Elementary School. And it has a reported capacity of 500, an enrollment of 298, and a reported capacity percentage of 59. And so let's take a look at what that looks like. It also happens to be 17 classrooms. But this is a diagram or a picture that shows you the entire crux of the debate here in Stanley County. According to this, it looks like we have a school sitting half empty. So we have 298 students in a school that reportedly can hold 500, and it's only 60% full. So you cannot, I guess, you can't hold it against anyone why they might think that if this case exists in other schools around the county, why it should be an easy decision to close schools and consolidate schools. However, if we take a look at the utilization of this school, just like Oakboro, we see that all but one room is actually being utilized, and not just by students. But the one room that isn't being utilized was a classroom, but it developed a leak, so they're using it for storage right now. But they're using it for PT, AIG, they're using it for art, and by the way, one of these classrooms, the PT-OTS, is used as a hub for PT, physical therapists, and occupational therapists that travel around the county, and they used to be located in the central office, but they ran out of space, so they put them down in Aquadale in one of the rooms. So, again, if you look at the reports in the public, the reported capacity is 59%, but this utilization is 96%. So, we wanted to be able to put these capacities in context, and that's what we've been talking about. So, I have two diagrams to show you, and these are all the elementary schools in the county. What you see up here on the left-hand side is the capacity, the same numbers that I was referring to earlier, the number of students that are enrolled, and those are the number of students that are enrolled as of spring break, and then what the capacity percentage is. So we're not even going to dispute any of these numbers because, quite honestly, it's irrelevant. Because if you look, we see a lot of quote-unquote half-empty schools or close to it. But if we take a look at utilization, now we have 96, 100%, 97%, 95%. We have every one of these floor plans documented, and you'll notice that the only school with 3 quote-unquote empty classrooms happens to be Indy Elementary School, and that happens to be Mobiles, but one of the Mobiles is being used for YMC after-school program. And they have storage and the other two. So it is a completely different picture than you get if you just look at the capacity numbers that have been provided by the school system over the last 5 or 6 years. And I'm going to get ready to turn it over to John. John is a numbers guy here. So what we wanted to do was we recognized that you couldn't look at the capacity numbers without tying them to utilization. Mm-hmm. And just as an FYI, capacity is essentially the number of students in a given school, and the utilization would be what classrooms you're using inside of the school. So I want to bring up a chart. Now, it's going to be hard for you to read here, but just this is a snapshot of one of the 11 elementary schools. At the top, you're going to see the different class, the grades, and how many students per grade. And then we have the available number of classrooms on the left-hand side just below that. And I'm going to turn it over to John, because what we wanted to do was we created a scale. We have an ideal scale, and we have what we call a maximum scale that takes capacities but puts them in a context of utilization. So John, go ahead and take over.
Yeah, so when we were compiling this data, we wanted to look at a couple of things. Number one, we wanted to see the available rooms in every school. And then we wanted to take a look at what the state says, or the state mandate for this year. It happens to be K through three, 20 students per teacher, 20 per class, with a max of 23. And then fourth and fifth grade, and this was universal. Every principal we spoke to told us their target number was 25. Or less. They didn't want to go over 25. So for fourth and fifth grade, we use 25. So if you look here on the left under the ideal, you can see that on this left column, we have listed out kindergarten, K first, combo, first, second, third, on down to fourth and fifth. And we have the number of classrooms. Well, to get our capacity calculations for K through third, we use 20 students per classroom, which is the state mandate. And then when we got down to fourth and fifth, we used 25. And, you know, we're trying to get as close to the reported numbers as possible. Now, in addition to these classrooms at Aquadale, we have a music room, an art room, a STEM lab room, an EC room, AIG, curriculum, intervention. We have pre-K EC speech. We have actually two pre-Ks. And I'll stop on pre-K there. Pre-K, we have six pre-Ks?
Yes.
Six pre-Ks in the counties, and I can tell you this, not one pre-K child shows up in a capacity chart anywhere in our school system. So they're there, they're taking up classrooms, but they're not included in a capacity study that you get. So they're not included in those enrollment numbers, per se. So that, you know, takes away some class space there. Then we have, of course, Anthony was telling you, the PTOTs, and then we had the one empty space. So to be fair, we went ahead and we're going to utilize that empty space in an ideal situation. We're going to put 20 more students in there. So retaining all of these things that they're using at Aquadale, we come up with an ideal capacity of Aquadale of 365 students. Now, I'm going to move you to the right on that same line item, because after next year, in 1920, and 20 and 21 and 21 and 22, as you guys are aware, the state mandate keeps ratcheting down till we reach the final in 21 and 22. Take a look at what that does to our ideal capacity. It goes from 365 to 354 in 2 years. The third year is 343, and then in 21, 22, it's 330. Now, to the right, you're gonna see our max capacity. Everything's the same there, except the three classes highlighted in red. So to try to reach as many students or get as close to the reported numbers as we could, we went ahead, not that we wanted to, but we went ahead and got rid of the AIG classroom at Aquadale. So we'll find somewhere else for the AIG kids to get pulled out and do their work. We got rid of the multi-purpose curriculum room, and we got rid of the multi-purpose intervention. What you'll see throughout all of our schools is we retain music, we retain art. Those are very, very important subjects and shouldn't be put on a cart unless you have to. If you're putting them on a cart, you're beyond max, in other words. We retain the STEM labs. Of course, we retain the EC rooms, and then our pre-K and our PT. So when you go through there, that gives us a maximum capacity for Aquadale of 425. Now, as you move right on that list, you'll see by the time we reach 21, 22, that capacity is down to 390. So bottom left of your screen, You see the reported capacity of 500 and the reported capacity percentage of 59%. Ideal is 365 this year. That's 86%. That's a big difference from 59. Actual cap match 425 is 74%. And our reported open seats, and this is something that's being shared out there, is 202 open seats. Ideally, there's 52 open seats at Aquadale, and match, there's 112. And if you move to the far right in 4 years, ideally, there'll be 17 seats and 77 in the match. And that is given. We are given here that we carried over this year's enrollment for each year because we, of course, don't know what the enrollment will be. So we're going to do one more school like this because
not the whole thing.
We can't stay there for all 11 of the elementaries. But this is a snapshot of Baden. So same thing. So Baden is already at 100% utilization. They have a music room, art guidance, AIG, EC, EC speech, and a STEM CP computer lab. So they don't have an empty room at all. So their total enrollment, if you put in the 20s for K through third and 25s and fourth and fifth, is 440 students. While it's been purported that they can hold 532 students. 89% is what's being told. Actually, right now, in an ideal situation, 105%. So you have a Baden school that we're being told has room, but ideally, they'll probably have more students than what they should to have all those classes. And if you look over at your third, fourth, and fifth grades, you'll see almost all those classes at seed. They're 24, 25. They're up there pretty high, and the second grades are 22, 21. So they're pushing the limits on the state mandate, and that's why that would be. And then if you move over to the far right, you'll see at ideal capacity, we're at 118%, and our max in 4 years will be at 105% at Baden, given like enrollment as to what we have today. Open seats were 60. We actually have 24 more than we should ideally today. And max situation, we're at 26. And you can see that the one classroom over in the max side that we felt like we could make room for more students is, again, we took away the academically gifted programs or their space. We'll have to find somewhere else inside the building for them, those teachers to pull those students. Okay.
All right. Go ahead. Yeah, I'm going to jump back. Okay, so this is the data. We know you can't see this. This is the data for all 11 schools. And the only thing that you really need to pay close attention to on this screen is that you're going to see all the red. And essentially what that means is that ideally, like John said, you want to keep your music and your art and your AIG and your EC rooms. Well, you're always going to keep your EC no matter what. But if you move from ideal to maximum, there's a sacrifice that you have to make. There's a sacrifice that the teachers have to make, that the principal has to make. It's additional scheduling when you start taking and eliminating those classrooms for those dedicated purposes. It's not that you don't do it. If you have to do it, you have to do it. And you'll have to do it because the bottom line is, like John said, we're not at 59, we're at 86. We're not at 62, we're at 98% when you actually dig down into these schools with respect to utilization. Yeah, let me go back.
Back up to that one. I just wanted to add one thing. We're going to provide the board with every one of these sheets. And yeah, we'll provide these all to you, a detailed report. So
here's the summary. I'm going to let John run through this real quick because we have one more section after
this. Okay, so just, the fit within the time limit. We showed you the small snapshot, two schools, and we're going to provide you the other nine. But here's school-wide elementary summary. 17 and 19, our enrollment from visiting schools was 4,011. The reported capacity of our schools, what's being shared out there, is 5,355, and that we are at 75% capacity as all our elementary schools combined. Ideal capacity is 4,515. Based on what we shared with you, and that's 89%. That's a difference of 840 students. Max capacity, 4,985, that's 80%, and that's a difference of 370 students. And then if you go all the way over to 21-22, we're looking at if the enrollment was still 4,011, and it was still being reported 5,355, we're actually gonna be ideally at 4,103, which is 98% of capacity. And then on our mats, we're going to be at 4,573, which is 88%, which is a 782
student difference.
Right. I'm going to jump down to the bottom. And the open seats. So in what's been shared publicly recently, there are 1,367 supposed empty seats. Now, one thing about that is you can't dictate where students go. We're not busing kids. It's not like, you know, it's they say, Oakboro says, well, we have three extra third graders and we're going to ship those off to Richfield. And Richfield, we're going to trade you for six of your fifth graders. It doesn't work like that. So you're never going to be able to fill every single seat, nor should you try to. However, there are realistic numbers for empty seats. And based on our calculations on our ideal capacity, we're at 504 this year, and in 21-22, in 3 years, we're actually going to be at 92, only 92 empty seats in the elementary schools. Based on our maximum numbers, we're going to be at 974 available seats, which is closer to the 13, close to 1,400, and then 562 in year 21-22. The differences you can see there are pretty significant. From ideal, we are 863 less than the reported number, and we're 805 in the best case scenario years out in our most maximum calculation. So what I want to do here real quick is we want to shift gears to the K-3 class size mandate, because this is where the rubber meets the road. Mm-hmm. So and I'm going to turn this over to John, and we're going to go through the next 4 years here. So go ahead.
And this is where our attention really should be and what we're preparing for in the future.
How much longer are we looking at here?
With our elementary.
How much longer are you talking about?
We're two pages.
Two
we're
slides.
Done.
Two slides.
The K-3 state mandate, 2017-18 and 18-19, you can see here. So this year and next year is 20 students per teacher with a maximum of 23 and an LEA average of 20 or less. Now you can see there's only one red mark here. We have one class this year at Baden that exceeds the maximum. Easy fix, they have other classes to shift the student. So no problem, and we hit the numbers. 19-20, we start picking up a couple issues, because in 19-20, in 3 years, it drops to 19 students, max of 22, an average of 19. Here you can see, first off, that Baden has three classes over the max allotment. Richfield has one, and our second grade LEA average is out of compliance. 2021, again, we drop to 18 students, max of 21, average of 18 or less. Here we have Baden now has five classes out of compliance: Richfield 2, East Albemarle 1, Norwood 1, Millenport 1, Indy 1, and now our kindergarten, our second grade, and our third grades LEA average is all outside of compliance. And then finally, 21-22, and this is the year when the state mandate takes full effect. 18-1 in kindergarten is the ratio, 16-1 in first grade, 17-1 in second and third, with a max of 3+ and an LEA average of 18, 16, or 17, depending on the grade level. Here, you can see we have many issues throughout the system. Baden has eight classes over the max allotment. Richfield has six, East Albemarle has two, Norwood has three, Millenport has one, Stanfield has one, Indy has two, Aquadale has four, Central has two, Oakboro has two, Locust has one over the max allotment, and all levels, K through third grade, are outside of compliance with the LEA average on the new state mandate.
And last part of this is this. These numbers right here are using the current numbers
the
that
current
are presented
enrollment.
By SES. That is not our ideal numbers. It is not our max. That is the county's numbers. So when you factor in the utilization, then this gets, what it means is it's going to apply a lot more pressure. And just to put it into practical terms, right now we calculate that the school system in 3 years is going to be short at a very minimum 14 classrooms. I know that the central office believes it could be as high as 30. If you had closed Oakboro and kept Oakboro closed, you would need 34 classrooms in 3 years. If you had closed Oakboro and Norwood, you would need 54 classrooms. Mm-hmm. So thank God that you opened Oakboro back up, because now we're probably only going to need between 14 and 30 classrooms in 3 years.
And the last thing, the takeaway from this whole report is, if we're going to do a capacity study, you can't do it without considering utilization, because you got to consider the pre-Ks, you got to consider the ECs, you got to consider music and art. We can't just assume we're going to put that on a cart. In my opinion, as a parent, I'll be upset when my kids' music and art gets put on a cart, quite honestly. I'll feel like we're over capacity at that time, not being efficient. So thank you so much.
Any questions? Thank you.
Anybody?
And we will present, we will provide a complete report with all of this detailed for you guys, but we needed to distill it down.
We've done the same thing for the middle schools and the high schools, but we had no time to do that tonight. So we'll provide you a report or get back together with the information, provide you everything from K through 12th grade countywide. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Chair will take a declare a 5-minute recess before we continue on with the rest of the agenda. Remember, we'll do that before we take a break. You got a question?
I do. I have a question. I also have just a statement. Thank you both for all your hard work. That's impressive. I can't wait to dig in and look at it. As a matter of fact, I would like to have another session where we all sit down because this is so important. Maybe the most important thing we have to look at, if we can sit down and maybe have a session with y'all leading us through the middle school and the high school numbers as well. That's just something that I'll request, but I've been involved for some time and know these numbers pretty well, and have seen, and I'm glad my instincts were right, and there are five of us on here right now that who had the same instincts when we fought for community schools and for no closures of our elementary schools. So I'm very glad that we didn't, seeing that we could be in a situation that we would regret. But I do have a question. If, for people out there that don't know the numbers, the obvious question is, about 20 years ago, we had 10,000 students in our school system. Mm-hmm. So how did we fit these students in there? And
How do we do it then, but exactly. Now it wouldn't be ideal or wouldn't fit our max?
Well, so John and I, there were a couple things. One thing that we learned, and I don't know how many of you knew that pre-K was not added into any of the enrollment numbers, but there are 6 pre-K classes, and we didn't have 6 pre-K classes 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. The other thing is that CTE has increased significantly across the school system. The number of CTE classes, and CTE classes have a federally mandated maximum of 20 students per class. Mm-hmm. So that also mm-hmm. eats up classrooms.
Speaking on the CTE also, like when I was in college, I think we had 6 CTE courses at West Stanley. Now I think they have, is it 17, 14, somebody might could tell. Yeah. But it's more than double that, and not only could we put 30 kids in a class back then, which was very common, now the state says they only can put 20 in those classrooms. So, you know, over time with the state mandates and with the different offerings coming into schools, it whittles away at your capacity numbers. It just does. It's not like when I was at Oak Bear Elementary, you walked in my classroom and we had 6 or 7 rows of 6 desks. You know, everybody sat in a line and you raised your hand and you had your books underneath you and you had your pencils underneath. Now, if you walk in an elementary school, it's a small group. They have stations. They move back and forth. They don't use the classrooms in the same fashion that we used as early as 2000s or 90s. So you know,
there's
you can't
other
go
stuff,
by old numbers.
We're running out of time.
I would inject too. We were adding modulars on a regular basis back then too.
Yeah, that was the last thing I was going to say.
And we've retired a few.
We've
too,
retired some, and then, some too. Have been closed because of moisture issues and things like that. So mm-hmm. that we calculated based on a pre-K, 100 to 120 students. Mobiles, we calculated anywhere between 100 and 200 students. And that fluctuates depending upon every year. The principals will make use of mobiles, and if they don't have to use them, then they bring the kids inside. And one last thing is North Stanley High School on their math hall, which is outside downstairs, if you've ever been to the school, I think it's like 6 classrooms. They're using none for classrooms. One is designated for in-school suspension. One is used by the school resource mm-hmm. officer, because 4 of the other classrooms have moisture problems. And they also, if we were going to open that back up to bring students into North Stanley, because it's excellent, the hall is great, you would have to put a sound barrier in all of those rooms, and you would also have to address the moisture issue. They have dehumidifiers that are running in all of those rooms to keep the humidity mm-hmm. down. So those are some of the issues that you have too, where you could free up more classes, but there'll have to be some maintenance that's done.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else have any questions before break?
I do. And I think, Anthony,
you just kind of hit on something. You know, since I've been on this board, I haven't heard talk of we're going to close schools.
No.
I mean, that I just have not heard talk we're going to close schools. I think we have looked at numbers. We have numbers. Am I correct, Dr. James? We have numbers. Here's something, though, you just said with, and this is is where I'm wanting to go. Like, I know when I ran for school board, I wanted to develop that 3-year, that 5-year, that 10-year, that 15-year plan. Mm-hmm. I believe we've got someone in place now who has that vision and is going to be doing that. When you mention North Stanley, you know, not only safety are you looking at that school, which is big to me, but I look at this, not closing a school, but I think here's where we need to be doing some studies, like how much money are we going to spend in 5 more years, 7 more years to address these problems and that need to be addressed and to keep our schools up, or and again, I may get shot right here for saying this, or do we tear down a school and do we build a new school? Because here's where we're shortchanging our students, I think. One, and we have a packet of information here, and I'm so happy that Sean Britt sees this and Dr. James, but we've got to have broadband. We're shortchanging our kids, and we've got to provide that technology. Can we do it? Continue to do it in our high schools? Our high schools is what I think is where I want to see and address situations. We're going to remodel. Are we going to tear down? We're going to rebuild. But there's safety issues, and there's also that maintenance issue.
Yeah,
yes.
Can I mention just one thing? So when we toured the high schools, the one thing that we asked, the biggest issue that's brought up is equity to access of classes in the schools, especially at the high school level, particularly AP classes. Mm-hmm. So the first school that we went to, we had an idea. We spoke with Dr. Jeff James about this, was why don't we use the satellite classrooms? You could broadcast, you could have the same AP classes in every school every day, whether you had one student or 14 students
that
wanted to take
the
class. We got to the first school, the first high school. We asked to take a look at the room. They said all the equipment was removed several years ago. We went to the next high school. We asked to look at the room, and we're not talking about the distance learning lab. That's up and operational and great and packed every school we went to. Satellite room, the equipment was taken out several years ago. All four high schools, they could have had, and this is what irritated us, they could have had several years ago all the AP classes in every single high school in Stanley County if they had not taken that equipment out and they had used it. It was already in place. And it can be replaced, but and probably with better stuff now, but that's something they can do. And they do have the space allocated for it in our high school thing.
Right. See that. So sometimes I think we get, to me, like hung up on the number. But again, I think that we have got to start looking at down the road the cost of the facility. And again, here's something else this county's got to come through with. We've got to pass that quarter-cent sales tax.
That's right.
This county has got to do that. Our commissioners have got to address it, and they've got to get out and work toward having it passed, because we are shortchanging our students in the long run. Yep. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
No one else. We're going to take a 5-minute recess. Thank you. Chair, we'll call the meeting back to order. Next item is approval of minutes. You have a copy of minutes before you from the last meeting. Are there any corrections or additions or deletions to the minutes for April 12th meeting? Hearing none, they will stand approved as presented, and we will go into committee reports. instructional program, Ms. Glenda Gibson.
The instructional committee met last Thursday, April 26th, and at that time, Dr. James laid out his plans for each of our high schools as well as grants that he is pursuing. You also heard this last Saturday at our work session. So I'm going to call on Dr. James, if he will, so that he can present this publicly to the board as well as those of you in the audience again. Thank you, Dr. James.
Thank you, Co-Chair Gibson and board members and Chairman Poole. We'll pull up some things that we talked about Saturday at our work session, some things that the curriculum team has been working on for quite a while. While we've had very few things to do but outside of this, I'm sure. But we have been able to put together a program we think will help us academically across our district. So I'll talk through these. if you look at the flow chart, North Stanley High School, and actually we talked about this at our board retreat Saturday, and we've talked about it on and off amongst members for several weeks now, but here's our plan for our school system to actually, we keep hearing the word equity, and I've heard it several times tonight, to ensure that all of our students across our district have an opportunity to take the courses they choose. And our plan has been submitted to the curriculum committee. We would like to make our high school schools of choice. And we've thought about this, laid it out very methodically, and I hope through the vote tonight we're given the permission to proceed. Some of these programs will take this year to get ready to implement them the following year. Some of them we can go ahead and implement this coming fall. So North Stanley High School, our thoughts there would be to look at an international baccalaureate program with a career program component. International baccalaureate actually begins, the IB program, as it's referred to, begins in the 11th and 12th grade. It consists of six classes. These are very rigorous classes. Typically, these are students that are in the top 5 or 7% of their class. So when you look at our junior class, you take the capacity of that class, multiply it by 7%, and that's typically the number of students that would be in this program. I will tell you historically, those numbers tend to run above that, but that's the goal of the program. And again, we offer that opportunity to any student that has the ability to step up for an IB program. This program takes a year to actually entertain International Baccalaureate Commission to come in, look at our schools. So in this process, we actually have to have our teachers in place this fall. We'll also have to have a principal in place in this program also this fall. So what we would entertain is that we open that up for interviews, of course, and look at the requirements for the International Baccalaureate Program to ensure that our teachers meet those minimum requirements. The professional development in this program, part of the cost to kick it off, and I will tell you in the past, the fees made it very difficult for rural counties to apply, but they have come down substantially. Actually helped bring this program to Iredell County, which is now about 2,500 students. It's actually an IB high school program, a middle years program at the middle schools, and now they have started an elementary program. So you can back it down to engage students all the way to the elementary level, but typically it started at the high school or middle years. We would like to start it at the high school level because we would like to offer students in our county the opportunity to gain a rigorous program if they feel like they're not currently getting it. So I know that maybe we've lost some students to Greystone that felt like maybe the rigor wasn't in our schools at this time. So the IB program will definitely ratchet it up. You will not get another program in a high school that contains any more rigor than International Baccalaureate. And it's maintained because they come in and do observations. They require continual professional development for your teachers, and they have to show that they have the ability to teach the program. So it's an audit process. They ensure fidelity to their program. It's a three-year process, so we would be a candidate school. So we would be observed for 3 years, and in year three, we would be told if we are granted IB status. So it takes that long to get all the things in order and get all the processes in order. So again, very important that you have the right teachers, right principal to lead this program. A new program that International Baccalaureate has added is a career program. So here's what it does. So if I really don't want to take the six classes to get my International Baccalaureate degree, I can take two of those classes and I can do a career path in CTE or a credentialing path. So that allows students to also get that on their diploma. And here's where IB helps you. And it is different from AP, and we'll have a presentation on that the next meeting. But there is a huge difference. But the IB program, typically schools that are Ivy League respect an IB diploma. If you're trying to get into one of those schools, it will get you quite a few points on the application process. The CP program, just a step down, is also gaining momentum out in the marketplace as a great program. And again, in dealing with International Baccalaureate years ago and bringing the program into Iredell County, it is a great program. It is for only, I think, a certain percentage of our students that want to excel, but it does offer them that opportunity. So what we're trying to do is make our high schools choice schools. So let me run through real quick. The Albemarle High School is a great location in the future because Pfeiffer is building a new university downtown about a mile away, and that university is going to be Health and Human Services. In the Pfeiffer addition downtown, they're going to offer a master's program and an opportunity to become a physician's assistant. So it excites me because you could actually, if we put this program, actually start in kindergarten, come all the way through our system, go through Pfeiffer, and walk out a physician's assistant. Very few counties in this state will be able to say that. So we have some great things coming up academically for our students in our county. I think we're really setting on the next opportunity to see this county grow. The Pfeiffer addition will definitely bring additional people in seeking a physician's assistant's degree. And if you ever talk to anyone who's tried to get that, it's almost as difficult as getting your medical doctorate. So excited about that. We will partner. We've already had discussions, been going on for about 2 months with Pfeiffer and Stanley Community College. It fits right into what they already have in place. So this will be an additional offering for our students to get into an early college program. And you heard Mr. Adams tonight speak about what the great things that are going on at the early college program. So just think about that and having the capacity to do it two different places in our county. So interesting times coming ahead for our students, I believe. So West Stanley, what we would like to do at West Stanley has a phenomenal drama department and arts program, and I know that part of the county leans towards that and are doing some great things. So what we would like to do at West Stanley High School is offer an A-plus arts program. There is a fee to that. The International Baccalaureate fee is right at $13,000. You do pay a fee each year. It's right at $10,000. And that's through the candidacy, and then after you become an IB school, then there's about a $10,000 fee each year. Considering we have a $73 million budget, I don't really consider that an obstacle. And trust me, I found $785,000, so I can find 10. So not a problem there. And the next thing we're thinking about is South Stanley High School. We would like to do an AP Academy. Again, we would interview the teachers for this AP Academy and put it in place. So I know that Anthony spoke about distance learning, and I didn't even put it up on the screen. We could talk for an hour on all the things we have going on. The distance learning equipment we had was out of date. So the new distance learning telepresence is what it's referred to. It's actually almost being in the room with the individual. The clarity is that great. I've also been part of bringing in Montgomery two of those grants that were somewhere over $600,000 or $700,000 that brought in telemedicine and also telepresence for education. So some great things out there. We're working on two grants. We just had a grant meeting yesterday morning, I believe, or maybe it might have been this morning. Well, it's been a long week. I actually started in this job, I was 29, so you can tell what happened to me in 2 months, so I'm aging. So we had a great meeting with the telepresence people. We feel good about a USDA grant we're applying for. It's $500,000. I'll talk about grants next. I'll pull that slide up because it fits under curriculum, but telepresence, we'll put it in all four high schools. That will give us the opportunity, if I have a master teacher sitting at South Stanley High School, to beam into the other schools and be present for all the students so that the best teacher can be present in front of all the students interested in taking that course. In doing that, we lower our cost for the teachers on the other end, and we're able to possibly offer those teachers doing that additional dollars. And how hard it is to keep science and math teachers now, we need to be thinking out of the box on how we can find additional money to keep them in the classroom. So the other one we'll talk about is Indy. And I've interviewed quite a few people, and when I interviewed the board, Indy kept coming up as a great place to start dual immersion. And if you look at the capacity numbers, it's probably the best place to put it. It's also centrally located, so it provides equal access for our entire community. Dual immersion, as a matter of fact, I just read an article today from MIT, and what the article said, and we talked about this Saturday, but the best way to learn another language is below the age of 10, not after it. And we're doing this backwards. We're giving language to our students starting in 8th grade through 12th. And yes, they can speak a little bit of Spanish, but they are not truly bilingual. So when you start a dual immersion program in kindergarten, those students actually are truly bilingual students if they stay in the program and go through 5th grade. And I did tell the board Saturday when we visited Iredell County, they have a great dual immersion program. The AP Spanish students actually challenged the 5th grade dual immersion students to a contest on who could win in Spanish. And I would say that the 5th graders beat them, and now they will not compete again. So a great way to build dual language. And I will tell you, in today's world we're operating in, and I've worked with a lot of Latino students, and I said, you guys really have a gift because you're bilingual. And if you get the education to go with that gift, you guys can name any job you want and walk into it. So, I mean, I'm excited. It gives me cold chills to think about all the great things that we have available for our students. The world's at our feet, guys. And the only limitations are between our two ears. So we're definitely thinking outside the box. We're excited to roll this out and just need board approval after this. But I want to talk about grants while we're at it because they roll into this picture too. I had grants on slide two. So grants. So we have several grants going on. Teacher Quality Partnership. We are working with Pfeiffer on this, Stanley Community College, and also Montgomery County Schools. We actually need 10,000 students to apply for this grant. It's a 5-year, $1.5 million grant per year. So my Common Core math tells me that's $7.5 million. So somebody do the regular math and see if that comes up with the same number. I think it should. But great partnership here. And what this does is provide tremendous support for beginning teachers through this entire process for 5 years. So it starts with a cohort of teachers and it follows them, provides the support to actually help build more teachers for a classroom. The sad part, I've actually talked to about 100 students at the student advisory at each one of the high schools and middle schools. And the sad part of that, I've talked to over 100 students. And out of that, only one student wanted to go into education. And that was really sad. So we've got to think of other ways to get students to think about education as a career. This is a way to take those young teachers that a lot of times that's our turnover from year 1 to 3 because of lack of support. And one of the things that got cut years ago was beginning teacher support from the state. So this is a great way, if we get this grant, to support our teachers and build a teacher pipeline for us in Montgomery County. Gear Up Grant. Actually, Montgomery County started this grant before I left. Montgomery County has asked us to join them in this grant. This actually starts with 6th graders and does a cohort and follows those 6th graders all the way through high school graduation and the first year after high school graduation. And its intent is to put additional support services in the classroom at 6th grade and work with at-risk students to make sure that we're using every resource available to make them successful in their education career. This grant is $1.3 million, so that we're in the process of that one. The DLI, Digital Learning Initiative, here's a grant we just applied for. We'll know here probably June 1st. But here's what we're hopefully going to use our money for to put in the telepresence. So we're going to put in 4 systems initially, and then the RUST grant comes along. It's $500,000. It will allow us to put telepresence equipment in every school. And think about that, at having an elementary school that can do a partnership with a European country. That would be just great to do pen pals and be able to talk to each other. I actually had a teacher that had a group of scientists at the Ring of Fire, and the kids were able to Skype in, and it was almost like you could smell the salt air doing a lesson with kids. And you want to talk about engaging students, you can bring the world to their classroom. So excited about telepresence. The other grant that we've applied for is 21st Century. I know Susan Brooks and is working on that and pulling most of the data together, but it's $1.4 million, and our goal is to serve 250 students after school. It's 12 hours a week, 36 weeks during the year, and 34 weeks during the year, and 6 weeks during the summer. It'll provide assistance to at-risk students. So we definitely have to look at the schools that have high free introduced lunch numbers to be eligible for that grant, but feel confident. I've received that grant about three times in my history in education. A wonderful grant. It's a way to provide additional community support. And I will tell you that the communities that grant has went into, the juvenile crime statistics dropped by about 40%. So it makes a difference when students are with caring adults and with people teaching them character education, instead of unfortunately, latchkey homes or without anyone at home to provide them a parental support. And that's just where we're at in our country. It's neither good nor bad. But just excited about these opportunities moving forward. So I think we have a lot of great things coming up. You heard a ton of great things tonight. Again, just my passion is curriculum and doing things for kids. And this was just inspiring tonight to hear the great data we have. It would be even more wonderful if it was always out in the press of the great things we do, but sometimes not everything we do great gets front page. So we need to get our story out. We're working on a marketing plan for our district, and we're definitely going to tell our story. And tonight you heard a lot of great things that we can tell. So I'll entertain any questions.
Anybody got any questions? Okay. Still got the floor.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. James. To say I'm excited about this would be an understatement. I've been waiting a year and a half or more to see a direction like this, so I'm overly excited. So the instructional committee is requesting that the board allow Dr. James to move forward in pursuing his plans for the four high schools and the grant applications.
Okay, the motion out of committee is to instruct Dr. James to proceed with implementation of the plan he presented tonight.
Second.
Okay, don't need a second. There's any discussion or further questions?
I just want clarification. If we're going to be voting on this, this is a vote to move forward with the research phase of this, correct? And we would have to vote additionally,
yes,
to make it actually happen after we have all of the information in front of us, correct?
That is correct. What we would do is move forward, because the application process for IB has to be in soon, and that starts the process of picking a dance partner and moving forward. So we'll have to meet again probably by the end of May, because we'll have to make some decisions, because IB, we need to actually interview for principal and teachers for next year and the AP Academy. The other components can wait, but those two we'll need to move forward on. So we can meet again as a committee in May and discuss that, and then decide to move forward next open board meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Any more questions from board members? All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye. Any opposed? No. Motion carries, and Dr. James got the signal to proceed there. You have anything else? Okay, if there's no objection from the board, we're gonna jump one of these committees up, because we have a couple of gentlemen here from Locust that wanted to present to the board just a little bit, and they've been waiting patiently. So if there's no objection, I'm going to let Ms. Watson go next with the Personnel Committee report, and have those gentlemen present their presentation.
We had a meeting on April 12th, and we had Captain Steve Smith there, and I think he and someone else with him is ready to present to us.
State your name and whatever again for the camera, please.
I'm Captain Steven Smith of the Locust Police Department.
Hi, good evening. My name is Cesar Correa. I'm the city administrator for the city of Locust.
During our meeting, our personnel committee meeting, we were speaking to let the board know that Locust is looking to implement a SRO at our elementary school. We're here tonight just to ask for permission to proceed on with this. With the day's incidents that are occurring, it's became an issue that we were worried about. It's not so much an inside issue as it is an outside issue. Locust would like to take the first steps to put an officer from our department inside Locust Elementary, and we'd like to do it before the school year is over with, because we have already identified an officer who is willing to take this position and go ahead. She has already been going to the schools, walking around, talking to the teachers, talking to the principals. They seem to love her. I didn't know she was even going down there, but we're just seeking permission to go ahead and start. This officer, if she sees that this is a position that she is wanting to accept during the school summer, the next 2 months when school's out, she will be sent to SRO school, advanced SRO school, and also DARE school before the next school year starts.
Anybody on board have any questions? I guess the chair would have one. I'm assuming if we proceed to allow them to do this, we still had to develop an MOU as we do with the Sheriff's Department for our SROs. So, hey, we'll take all the help we can get. I think the board will agree with that.
Yes, sir.
I just hope you weren't looking for money tonight when you came in here.
Well, not precisely tonight, and that's kind of also why I'm here. First part was to formally request your permission to begin this partnership with the school board so we can place Officer Tucker into the school and start assisting with the children and start developing that relationship with public safety at such a young age. We have been told that there is funding available from the state. We're not here to ask you, the Board of Ed, for any kind of funding, but we are told that there is funding available from the state. We're also told that we have a better chance of actually receiving that funding if that application comes from the school board. So what we would like to also formally ask you for is to please submit an application on our behalf for that funding whenever it becomes available. In the meantime, the City Council for the City of Locust has made a commitment to fund the position in full for the upcoming fiscal year. So we are ready to proceed, we're ready to move forward, and we're hoping that we can get your assistance in applying for the funding. And if it comes, great. If not, we will continue to fund the position in full.
Anyone want to make a motion on this issue?
Well, I will move that we allow Locust to have their own SRO in the school, and that we do what we can to assist them as far as their application process.
Okay, the motion is to allow Locust to implement a SRO program at Locust Elementary. I think if you could include in the motion, I guess our attorney would draw up the MOU, to develop an MOU to get what. Okay, is that good?
Yes, that is good. Yes.
Everybody understand
yes. What
you're voting on?
Yes.
Now? Just allow them to proceed with the process and our attorney to develop an MOU and to get with you gentlemen. Okay, any other discussion or questions?
Second.
Okay. Second, I'm sorry, thank you, Mr. Swanson. Getting the cart ahead of the horse here. Any further discussion then at this point? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, no. Motion carries. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you very much for your time and consideration.
Thank you. And I guess we should say thank you to the citizens of Locust, too, for being so kind and generous. Thank you. Okay, we'll drop back to facilities. Mr. Ryan McIntyre.
No report.
No report. Finance, Mr. Ryan McIntyre.
We had a finance committee meeting on April 17th.
in which we are going to be presenting some preliminary budget updates tonight for board approval to send to the county commissioners. And Dr. James is going to speak on those a little bit.
Okay.
Hey, Mr. McIntyre, board members. This is an abbreviated presentation we're going to do for the county commissioners for the sake of time, but it has the key points in it, so we'll run through that tonight. So our proposed budgets for 2018-2019 school year. So we have five strategic goals that we look at as a district, and we're required to by state law work towards these five strategic goals. These are also state strategic goals if you look at the state website. So the main goal is to prepare future-ready students. If you look at our first goal, budgets are a key component of making this a reality. Our future students will see continued technological advancements beyond our current state. So it is imperative that a sound basic education provide access to technology and training to prepare future-ready schools. As federal and state per-pupil funding declines, it leaves the burden on local government to ensure an education. The budget request that we will make aims at providing enough funding to ensure student access to an education. And of course, we all know that a key component to teaching is an effective teacher. Local funding helps provide incentives that help us attract qualified candidates, goal two of our strategic plan. We talk about local incentives, and actually there was a study that came out yesterday that compares all the counties across the state. And we compete, of course, with some of the larger counties in the state, so it's hard for us to attract teachers if we do not keep our local teacher supplement in line. And we'll be talking about that in upcoming board meetings. I have that information to provide to you this week. Another growing goal in our society, of course, is maintaining a safe learning environment. Capital funding, of course, is needed to add additional safety features at each of our schools. And again, as Locust Police Chief said, the current situation in our country, unfortunately, we need to be considering all points of access to our buildings, additional cameras, additional fencing, and other things to ensure that our schools are as safe as possible. So the next goal, engage community and other stakeholders. Of course, it takes a village. We simply need additional funds to engage our community through media and other means. The school system does not exist, nor can it, in isolation. Funding to market and engage our communities is a key component of a successful education system. And of course, last but not least, 21st century systems. Our goal here is designed to make sure our classrooms are equipped with technology as our future students will live in a world of rapid technological advancement and need the skills to navigate this. Again, a key issue with funding is keeping our technology up to date. So if you look at this for the upcoming school year, 2018-19, we're already facing a reduction in federal funding, and we have not got our budget projections for next year and a lot of our title allotments. So we don't know yet if we're going to see any cuts in those. But one we do know of that we have lost funding in is rural and low-income schools. Due to the economic growth in the county, we have lost the criteria to be awarded this particular grant. The next, increased employer's cost. The cost of living goes up every year for every organization. And I think sometimes we tend to forget about that when we're looking at budgets. But here's an idea of what it costs Stanley County schools or will cost next year. Our retirement rate is being raised from 17.13 to 18.44%. That will cost the county school system $585,507 over what we're paying this year. Also, insurance goes up every year, so we're going up from $5,869 to $6,104. So that's an additional $273,606. So basically, our employer cost is going up $859,113. So we've lost $179,000 in federal. We have an $859,000 increase in employee cost right off the bat for next year. So we're getting close to $1 million. Proposed state budgets. If you look at our budgets, we have state, federal, and local dollars. Our state budget is $52 million. It's our largest budget. And 91% of that, of course, is in salary and benefits. So again, I know some of the conversation when you talk about talk in the past, when you shut a building down, you could save money. Well, if you still have to have the people if you have the students. So again, 91% of that cost of operating a school is the employees, not the building. So of course, in this, the remaining percentage there is 8.9% instructional supplies, EC services, software, and development, other equipments and things. So altogether, our state budget for next year, $57,437,680. Proposed federal budget, again, federal budget is consumed mostly in salaries. 85% of the $4,487,466 we get, again, is spent in salaries. So additional support personnel that keeps class sizes low. Without that, we would see a much greater class size in K-5, but then we're mandated by the state not to have it in K-3, so then you have a situation where you have to figure out how do you spend your federal dollars to keep that class size well within the state limit. So without this federal dollar amount, we would have a hard time educating our students. So we're thankful for what we do get. 14.8% of that, of course, is instructional supplies. There's some equipment, travel, et cetera, in that. But our federal budget's $5,265,496. Grants, we do have some various grants that go into Fund 8. These add up to $370,967. Not a lot there. So in presenting to the county commissioners, I will tell the general public here, if you ever question the impact of public education, there's tons of studies out there. These are two that I will present to the commissioners. You can read them at your leisure. They all say the same story. Your quality of your public education school system, not charter, not private, not homeschool, your public education school system determines the economic development of your community. There is no arguing it. There's tons of data to show it. These are two studies that were done. I did not put a study here out of Virginia, but Dr. Jim Merle, who just retired as Wake County Superintendent, was also in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and actually hired a firm to come in and figure the return on investment for every dollar spent in education. There is an article I can get if you wish to review it. For every dollar spent in Virginia Beach, Virginia, there was a return of $1.53. I would definitely invest my money there if I can get a 53% return. So we need to think a little bit different, because in supporting our school system, we're supporting our future. And I do really want to retire at some point, and I hope that the economic development is going very well in the county I retire, so those students can pay my retirement. So it is an investment in your future. And the older you get, it's a bigger investment in your future. So I want to, of course, thank you for the presentation. Again, we do have a meeting set up, I believe, on May 14th to present to the county commissioners, and it'll be a little bit more detailed. But I certainly welcome the public to come out and be part of that conversation. So that concludes our budget presentation. Any questions?
Thank you, Dr. James.
Thank you.
We actually have three items that require board approval to go to the county commissioners. Two you have in your packet, one you received via email. The first we are going to take a vote on would be the Stanley County Schools 2018-2019 projected budgets.
Okay, the motion is to from committee is to approve the 2018-2019 budget request.
Correct.
I don't need a second coming out of committee. Is there any questions or discussions from any board members?
Chairman Poole, I did make that presentation that's going to be presented available to all board members. They have the PowerPoint and the actual budget numbers that was made available last week.
Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, no. Motion carries. Next one.
Second is the 18-19 capital budget request.
Okay. Should have before you a copy of the 2018-2019 capital budget request. That's one to the commissioners also. Don't need a second. Do they have any questions or discussion on that one? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed, no. Motion carries. The local exempt.
No, last is the presentation that we received via email
okay.
for Dr. James to take before the Board of Commissioners.
Okay, the motion would be to have Dr. James present the information to the commissioners for the budget request. Is that correct? Good enough. All right. Any further discussion on that? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed? No. Motion carries. Thank you. Anything else? Mr. McNamee. Okay. Policy, Ms. Crump.
No report this time.
Okay, no report. Dr. James, you have anything else?
Actually, National Teacher Appreciation is May 7th through 11th. I definitely want to send a big shout out to all of our teachers. A lot of research done. Bill and Gloria Gates Foundation spent over $1 billion to prove one thing, what we already know. The quality of a classroom teacher is the biggest determinant in the success of a student's education career. So my hats go off to all the teachers, and as I've told the board, had it not been for a fifth grade teacher that took time to build a relationship with me, I would not be sitting here tonight. So my heart definitely goes out to those teachers, and if I could wave a magic wand in our society and stop the demification of the teaching profession, I would, because there are no greater people sitting in this audience or in this country than teachers. The future presidents, astronauts, doctors, lawyers come through a teacher's class. So without a quality education, our society would not function. And actually, we would not be the great country we are without the one-room classrooms in the old schoolhouses that started our country. We would not have the democracy and the voice we have without that. So we tend to forget that as individuals. So I would challenge the adults in this community and communities throughout this country to stop the demification of the teaching profession and stand up and take appreciation for those great people that stay in classrooms in our country with low pay and low benefits to train the future of our country. So please just remember that. School Lunch Hero Day is May 4th, and School Nurse Day is May 9th. So just remember those dates. We'll also tell the board I was able to attend the state superintendent's meeting, and hopefully there will be additional funding coming from this general session for nurses, school psychologists, and hopefully some SROs. I have heard there may be some block grants coming, so if they are, of course, we'll be scanning for those on the horizon and making sure that we apply for any of those that come down to help make sure that our system's getting its fair share. So thank you, Chairman Poole.
Okay. Curriculum and instruction, Mr. Poppin.
Mr. Chairman, board members, I have one item that requires the action. I ask the board if you would approve June 6th and 7th as a 1 o'clock dismissal for middle school and high school due to the exams. The 6th is the last day for exams. Typically, we stay the second half of the day to tutor for the next exam that is given. And since the 6th is the last day and 7th is a makeup exam day, we traditionally dismiss, again, the middle and high schools at 1 o'clock. I ask that you would take action upon this, please.
I move that we make June the 6th and 7th half days, correct?
1 o'clock dismissal.
Okay, early dismissal. Okay.
The motion is to make June 6th and 7th.
1 o'clock dismissal.
1 o'clock dismissal.
That way we have lunch provided.
Okay. Second by Mr. Mack. Any further discussion or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Motion carries.
Thank you, sir.
Ms. Calvert.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, I'd like to refer your attention to personnel agenda in your packet. Section 1 is for your information only. You'll also see there's an attached list of all the teachers that will be considered for contract renewal at the June board meeting. So that's for information for tonight. And then Section 2 requires your action.
Move approval of Section 2.
Motion to approve Section 2 by Mr. Crumps, second by Mr. McIntyre. Any questions or discussion? Hearing none, those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed, no. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Ms. Hatley, Auxiliary Services.
Good evening. You have in your packets tonight two budget amendments, numbers 18 and 19. You also had in your seats or at your seats this evening a replacement for budget amendment number 18.
So we're voting on 18 and 19.
We're voting on 18 and 19. The first one, budget amendment 18, is with the State Public School Fund. The total appropriation is $54,277,087.28. These were adjustments made for actual revenues and expenditures.
Move to approve budget amendment number 18.
Motion to approve budget amendment 18. Do we have a second? Second by Ms. Gibson. Any discussion? Hearing none, those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed, no. Motion carries. Have a motion for 19.
Move to approve budget amendment number 19.
Motion to approve budget amendment 19 by Mr. McIntyre. Do we have a second? Second, Ms. Watson. Any discussion or questions? Hearing none, those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed, no.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I have for tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hatley. Public comments, and I appreciate the patience. We have one signed up, Alex Laws from Oakboro.
Good evening. My name is Alex Laws. My 12-year-old daughter, Thea, is a current sixth grader at Oakboro Choice STEM. She's an A honor roll student who scored a 4 on her fifth grade science EOG and a 3 in English. Thea is a class leader who excels with group work and presentations. She was runner-up in the school spelling bee this year, ran for student council secretary, and performed in the school talent show. She participates in drama club and has her first boyfriend this year. I make these comments to illustrate that Thea is not the stereotypical picture of an EC student. Yet she has a diagnosis that qualifies her for EC services. She is just like hundreds of other children in Stanley County classrooms in that she has an individualized education plan that stipulates which services and accommodations she receives due to a disability so that she is able to receive a fair and appropriate education. The right for EC students to do so has been hindered by the poor EC staffing at Oakboro. We currently have 2 EC teachers, but one is shared half a day with Indy School. Oakboro Choice STEM Administration has asked several times this year for the Board of Education to approve an additional full-time EC teacher, but has been denied. Despite what the allocation rules say about the number of EC teachers allotted a school, the reality is 1.5 teachers can only be in one place at a time trying to cover 9 grade levels. The inadequate EC staffing at Oakboro has led to the need to convert the week to a 4-day service week for EC students and reserve the 5th day for testing. It has also led the need to use a substitute EC teacher in my daughter's 6th grade math class this entire semester. Thea has EC services in math. This guarantees that she has her regular classroom teacher and an EC teacher who specializes in educating children with learning, emotional behavior, and physical disabilities. And the EC teacher is there to assist with the student to understand, helping them understand and apply instruction at grade level. Thea has math services 5 days a week. I have asked several times about the credentials of our substitute math EC teacher, but have not gotten an answer. Our substitute does not have a Stanley County Schools email address, so parents can't communicate with her about their children. Nor can Thea's teachers or EC staff communicate in an official capacity to guide her or to assess my daughter's needs or her progress. I went to my daughter's IEP meeting last week, and no one was able to give me any feedback from an EC perspective in math, as the substitute is not required to attend IEP meetings. Excuse me. Nor has there been any communication directly with her from my EC team. As of last week, Thea did not even know the EC substitute teacher's name, nor did she even realize that she was there to help her if needed. Thea describes that the EC substitute teacher walks around the classroom asking the students what they are working on, but states she has never received any assistance from her directly. Due to lack of personnel, Thea's testing accommodations of one-on-one testing in separate room this year have been to have her math tests administered by the school principal in the walkthrough to her office, where Thea can hear the office noise and while the principal is trying to run a school. This poor test environment has reflected in her math scores. I recently asked Thea be retested for the last math check-in for informational purposes for myself and her IEP team, and her math testing score went from 8% to scoring above the class average with proper accommodations. The current EC accommodations at Oak Bridge Hoyt STEM are unacceptable, and as a parent, we are in the process of meeting and reviewing with our IEPs for the upcoming school year, and we're slowly finding out that appropriate EC services have not been provided to our students, largely due to lack of staffing. I'm requesting that the Board of Education review their decision not to add an additional EC teaching position and grant this request as submitted by school administration. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Laws. Okay, superintendent comments.
Actually, I have none.
You don't have any?
I do want to say thank you to the students that were recognized tonight and all the accolades that they received. And again, it was my honor to actually be able to go down to the Skills USA competition just for an hour. I could steal away, but that's the best part of the job, is getting to see students succeed. So I would again say that our schools are doing some great things. It's just we're not getting all that out into the marketplace to advertise what we're doing, and we are working on that as we currently speak. So again, thank you, appreciate all the hard work, and again, thanks to our teachers, our nurses, and our nutrition staffs throughout our schools, and those appreciation weeks are coming up.
First, just like to say thank you to our East Albemarle jump rope team for coming out tonight. That was pretty awesome to watch. Also, congratulations to all of our award recipients. Thanks to John and Anthony for coming out and presenting tonight. A huge thank you to Locust and Locust PD for ensuring the safety of our students at Locust Elementary. And lastly, To Kevin Adams, thank you for coming tonight. It was wonderful to hear all of the great stuff that's happening at Stanley Early College. And like Chairman Poole said earlier, I could just sit here and let you talk all night. So thank you.
Ditto to that, Mr. Adams. I really enjoyed what you shared with us about all the good things going on at your school. And I know that we have wonderful things going on at all of our schools, and it's really refreshing to come and hear the bragging points when we can come in here. Big congratulations to Mr. Miles Shin for that Levine scholarship that he has been awarded. That's amazing. I want to say a special thank you to John Edwards and Anthony Graves. I know you've put in a whole lot of work. That's just an understatement. Obviously, looking at it, it was hours and hours of work that also involved going to every single school and checking it out and walking into the classrooms. You should be commended for that, and I look forward to seeing the rest of the presentation.
Ms. Vaughn?
Just to somewhat echo what Patty and Ryan have already said, special thanks to East Albemarle Jump Rope Team. We just enjoy them whenever they come up and perform. Congratulations to all those who are recognized earlier this evening. And again, Mr. Adams, thank you for your presentation. Thank you to the Locust Police Department and the City Council for installing an SRO at Locust. And also, Dr. James, I thank you for your leadership. It's great to have a direction we can look forward to. And I just hope you get the support you need to make it all happen. And thank you for getting some grant writing in place.
Ms. Gibson.
Echoing the same, thank you and congratulations to everyone who received the awards and that were recognized tonight. Mr. Adams, it's wonderful what all is going on there at Stanley Early College. Thank you. And to our Locust SRO for getting that in place. I think that's wonderful. Dr. James, thank you for your vision and what you have in the works for us at Stanley County. The jump rope team, that was amazing. I think you and I should start doing that.
I remember doing that in school. I had trouble doing it then when I was more agile.
I know. But I know both of us were up here like, wow. Okay. That was awesome. A shout out to, I went this past Saturday, I guess it was, the West Stanley Main event. I've never been before. Won't be my last time. My pocketbook is a lot less, lighter. But that was amazing. That was really good, those that put that on. And there's someone here that I want to recognize. Mr. Asciutto, can you stand up a minute? I know that your son, Greg, is not an employee of Stanley County Schools, but I have watched the videos of him, and I know that he is in the a finalist for Charlotte Mecklenburg Teacher of the Year. And I think that, how many teachers are in Charlotte Mecklenburg? Like
8,700.
Wow. And I could just see it. It really touched my heart when I watched that, because I could tell that the students in that class respected him, and I could tell they appreciated him, and I could tell that he enjoyed being with them so much. I wish him lots of luck. I know that's coming up as far as when they decide that. But yes. And Mr. Poole, or Chairman Poole, I know that you know this lady. We lost a dear person in the Indy community, Miss Jeanette Allman, and she was a teacher assistant for years and years and years at Indy. And her daughter, Terry Heck, teacher in our system. So I know that Terry lost her mother today. And Miss Allman, I taught with her. She was a teacher assistant at Indy. Very, very sweet, sweet lady. I wanted to mention that.
Thank you. Mr. Schwanger.
I would just like to recognize at this time the North Stanley senior class.
Amen.
I had the privilege today of eating lunch with one of the adult family members that was touched by that, and the adults in that family were moved to tears the entire weekend. So I can only imagine the profound impact that it had on the students, but also the leadership among those students at North Stanley High. So I just, if you know anybody that attends North Stanley or that's a senior at North Stanley, or if you know any of the adults that our parents of those seniors at North Stanley, thank them, because they've done a wonderful job with the collective students at that high school.
Swanson.
You just took my thunder.
You can do it again.
I know. I just want to say, I on Facebook, it was just wonderful. The students at North Stanley are remarkable. I just, it's hard to... It's getting to me, but anyway, they were so wonderful in doing what they did, and I know those parents of those two are just elated. And I want to say thank you, Joy. for that. I know you had something in that.
So anyway, all the accolades tonight were wonderful. We have good things going on in Stanley County Schools, and I'm very proud to represent Stanley County Schools. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. I would just ditto on all the awards tonight, but just to add to agree with Mr. Swearingen and Ms. Watson, I think this act that was done by the students at North Stanley just flies in the face of what we hear so much about public education today. We have shootings and everything else going on in schools around, and that's what gets all the attention. But let me tell you something. What they've alluded to here is the real thing, and that's what reflects what Stanley County is all about. And I add my two bits to that, too. On some personal notes, and take you back down memory lane a little. Oh, by the way, Dr. James, thank you for all you've been doing in the system, and I think all the staff has been in high gear. I think you've had everybody in high gear, and I want to thank them for assisting you in whatever you've been doing. On a personal note, take you down memory lane. This goes back a few years, and as of tonight, I will have completed 20 years of service on the school board in Stanley County, and that in a long haul, but I've enjoyed it. But I want to give a shout out to Mrs. Honeycutt, who used to be on the board with me years ago, and as those of you that remember back, she and I were often at one another's throats, but I had a lot of respect for her. And Mrs. Honeycutt was a strong proponent of the IB program. And I think every year she brought it up. And it seemed like at that time, Dr. James, it was very expensive. And we just could never seem to get the willpower to get over the hump as far as spending the money that was required. And so, Mrs. Honeycutt, I think tonight you'll be happy that the board has finally moved to start in that direction. And I'll give a shout out to her for that. We will entertain a motion to go in close. Oh, the next board meeting, that's right. We got to decide on a date, thank you. Next board meeting will be in this location on June the 5th at 7 p.m. We need to decide, the commissioners want to have a joint meeting with us. Mr. Lucas had sent an email out. If anybody's got your calendar available that you can check, they have offered 3 days, Tuesday the 15th, which would be, 2 weeks from today, or Monday the 21st, or Tuesday the 22nd. So if you can give us some feedback on what date would suit you best. We'll, the 15th, the 21st, and the 22nd. Tuesday. Is that good with everybody, the 15th? 2 weeks from now?
May.
Our June meeting will still be on the 5th, but this is a meeting with the commissioners, the two boards. I'm good with the 15th. If everybody's good with the 15th, we'll go with the 15th. Do what? What about Tuesday the 22nd? Would that work for everybody? Okay, I'll tell you what we're going to have to go ahead and show our hands on which date works best and just go with the one we get the most there. How many is good with the 15th? Raise your hand. Okay. How many is good with the 21st? Let's go with the 21st then. Monday, that's a Monday. I think that was a majority of votes. 7 o'clock. Is that 7 o'clock? He didn't specify a time, but I think they've been meeting at 6, 5:30. Let's see if 6 o'clock would suit them.
Okay.
21st at 6 o'clock. Now, do they have that's a...
That's right.
That may be their meeting. They're on a summer schedule. Okay. Well, if they give us those 3 dates, they're good with their. Okay. unless we hear differently, be 6 o'clock on the 21st of May, which is a Monday evening. Did they say where they want to meet with us? Here, over in their conference room, or? Okay, we're going to go into closed session. I'm going to do the motion to go into closed session, but before we actually go into closed session, we've got another little item we're going to take care of en route, okay? So, the chair will entertain a motion to go into closed session for personnel matters under North Carolina General Statute 143.318.1186, student matters under North Carolina General Statute 143.318.1111A1, attorney-client matters, North Carolina General Statute 143.318.1183. Motion to go in closed session with Mr. McIntyre. Do we have a second? Second, Ms. Gibson. All those in favor signify by saying aye. And before we go, we have a little small matter to take care of tonight. It's come to the chair's attention that this is Dr. James's birthday tonight. And with that, you will join the board in singing happy birthday to Dr. James. When?
Sunday
night. We're a day late. Okay.
Saturday.
All right, that's right. We're going to sing happy birthday tonight, okay? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dr. James. Happy birthday to you. Thank you very much. Okay, we will proceed to closed session. Thank you. Call the open session back to order. I'd like to announce the submission of Ms. Glenda Gibson's name into the pool to be selected for the Legislative Committee for North Carolina School Board Association. We will await the results of that. Without any further we'll entertain a motion to adjourn by Mr. McIntyre. Second by Ms. Crump. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Meeting is adjourned. Motion carries.